Around the turn of the century, many communities in North America were trying to improve their transportation systems. A common solution was to develop interurban railways, with hundreds springing up across the US and Canada. These were electrified railways operating from town to town, often passing through farmland in between. Because many rural roads were unpaved at the time, these railways were a quick method of traveling to and from cities in relative comfort. Like streetcars, interurbans could travel through streets and navigate tighter corners than other railroads. A perfect example of this is the London and Port Stanley, seen here in virtual form. Can this Canadian interurban line from nearly a century ago live on in Microsoft Train Simulator? We'll find out at the Railyard. The London and Port Stanley Railway was built in 1856 and initially used steam locomotives, but by 1915 it was completely electrified by the City of London. This rendition for Microsoft Train Simulator was created by Wayne Campbell and includes the entire L&PS network from London to Port Stanley, Ontario, a distance of approximately 25 miles. It is set during the railway's heyday from 1915 to 1932. Besides being used by commuters, vacationers would board trains in London and ride them south to the beaches on the northern shore of Lake Erie near Port Stanley. During the summer, trains could be as long as 5 cars. The cars were designed to be driven from either end so as to alleviate the need to turn a locomotive or train around. The railroad was also used to haul a variety of freight traffic. Practically any type of commodity could be seen on the L&PS because it interchanged with 3 other railroads, Canadian National, the Wabash, and the Paramarquette. This traffic was predominantly handled by 3 box cab locomotives built by General Electric, but express freight was often dealt with by this motor car, E1. Out of all these commodities, though, coal was number one. Railroad car ferries would arrive in Port Stanley from Conneaut, Ohio, where hoppers were unloaded. From there, the cars would be dragged up the grade to St. Thomas in London, where the coal would be used for power. The virtual L&PS is designed to install as a mini route. Besides the route and rolling stock, it includes activities replicating the day-to-day operations one would have encountered in 1927. It also includes a program named Callboard, which can easily create activities for the route without using the activity editor. As was the case with most of the interurban railroads, the automobile eventually caught up. The London and Port Stanley abandoned its passenger operations in 1957, and even the arrival of 2 diesels could not save the line. In 1967, the line was sold to the Canadian National Railway. While most of the railway is intact to this day, it's just not the same without the wires overhead and the rumble of interurbans. Thank you. It is incredible how well Wayne Campbell recreated this line, both in feeling and precision, and the work he put in unquestionably earns the seal of approval. However, this route you are looking at is version 3, a project I worked on with a team of content developers. Even before my team and I upgraded the route in stock, it was a sight to behold, and I admired it because I saw it bring the story of this little route to an interactive realm. What was once only stored in the pages of books and the memories of the locals was made accessible to everyone who owned MSTS. Now, you have the chance to be a part of this history. So, just how good is the London and Port Stanley? I want you to be the judge of that. These railways were a click method of traveling to and from cities in relative comfort. I said click, didn't I? The railroad was also used to haul a variety of freight traffic, practically any type of commodity.